Your Highness, Professor Law, dear colleagues, dearest young scientists. It is really a pleasure and honor to be before you today. And I'd like to talk to you about the distributed ledgers and blockchain. So let me quickly recap for you what a blockchain is. It's a sequence of data organized in blocks, data block 1, data block K, satisfying the following three properties. First of all these blocks are to be readable by the entire humanity. How can we pictorialize this? By putting this data up in the sky, so every one of us is free to look up and see all the blocks. Well, despite we are so high, each one of us is able to write a transaction up, one line of this ledger. So this person there writes down his or her own line, say, in the next block. Readable by all, writable by all, and tamper-proof for all. Nobody should be able to alter what is written in every block, nor the order of the blocks. How do we pictorialize this? By putting these blocks in encased bulletproof glass chained all in the sky. Okay, the metaphor is getting harder and harder to sustain. But you see what it is, right? It's a common ledger that everybody can read, everybody can write, and nobody can change anything about it. And the blockchain holds a great promise for humanity. Who doesn't like a tamper-proof, a non-alterable database? Who doesn't of us does not like transparency? Who doesn't want to enable to developing trust between people who barely know each other? Thanks to these properties, the applications and use cases for blockchains are essentially limitless. However, there is an open secret. They don't quite exist. So blockchains have been so far an aspiration. But somehow we are very far with our technology to sustain and realize this aspiration. We want what is right now a pie in the sky, and we are quite there, very distant for it. And let me tell you why. Because, you know, it is a famous statement in blockchain called the trilemma, that whenever you want to generate a blockchain, you can satisfy at most two of the following three properties: security, decentralization, and scalability. Just imagine that. Assume that I'm a blockchain designer, you come to me and say, oh, welcome, what type of blockchain you want? Which property you want to miss? How about you missing security? Great choice. Of course not. How about missing decentralization? Well, if I miss decentralization, why do I want a blockchain? And how about, you know, perhaps a scalability? What do you want, a blockchain between your family and friends for a small club? No. Well, it's like to say, you know, I'll give you a choice. Which knee you want to be shot as? The first left knee or the right knee? There are no good choices here. So let me tell you that, fortunately, this is not acceptable, this trilemma, and actually is not true. So what the truth is that blockchains are very sophisticated technical constructs, and we need more technology. That's what we are here for, and the young scientists among us, to really make our life better by developing more and better technology. So in blockchain, what is the difficulty? How do we implement a blockchain? Well, there are two aspects to it. One is to build the chain. You know what? That is easy. We use some prehistoric cryptographic primitives, like, you know, one-way hashing. So you take the hash of a previous block and you embed it in the next block. Done. Everybody does that. What the dilemma is, what the challenge is, who chooses the next block? Because in a distributed setting, each one of us that does a transaction propagates the transaction through the network. That's easy. You tell 10 people, each one of them tells to 10 other people, pretty soon everybody sees it. But at any point in time, the new and valid transaction that I see, namely the next block in the sequence, the next page on the ledger, to me is this. To you, is this, because I miss some transaction that you have seen, and you miss at any point in time some transaction that I've seen. And that's a big difference, because you want to have a really total agreement, total common knowledge of what the blockchain is. So the real difficulty is choosing the next block. Well, we have various techniques for choosing the next block. The first one was a great idea, was the first idea, but it doesn't quite bring us where we want to be, is proof of work. That was Nakamoto's idea. You know, who chooses the next block? Let's have a competition, a computational competition. Each one of us tries to solve a very complex riddle that requires a lot, tons of computation. The first one to solve it has the right to append the next block in the sequence. Ready, go, compute, 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 until one of us succeeds and posts this on the chain. What is the disadvantage of this? First of all, the costs are enormous. The waste of electricity is stunning, very costly. Second of all, it's very slow. Why is it very slow? Because the computational riddle has to be so hard that no matter how many people try to solve it, you need to have one solution roughly every 10 minutes. Why? Because if two of us solve the riddles a few seconds of each other, in the blockchain, it's not a chain anymore, we have a fork. And anytime we have a fork, one of the two branches is going to die off. And which branch is going to be? Perhaps the one in which your payment made to you appears. So you cannot speed it up by making the riddle easier so that you can produce a block, say, every 1 minute. Because if you budget for one solution every 10 minutes, occasionally you are going to have two solutions a few seconds of each other. But if you budget for a solution every minute, say, then the possibility of having two solutions a few seconds of each other goes so much high that you no longer have a chain. You have a kind of a mess of spaghetti, you know, exponentially big, in which you cannot even find where the longest chain is. So I don't mind personally sometimes, if I can afford it, expensive and fast. But expensive and slow, that's a hard sale. In addition, proof of work has generated concentration of power. What did we want? A decentralized blockchain. But if you look, you know, proof of work blockchains are actually dominated by two or three mining pools. That is extremely concentrated. Okay, next idea. Next idea is another simple idea, is a delegated proof of stake. What does this mean? Look at these 21 people. Don't they look honest? Well, if they look honest, perhaps they are honest. Let's put them in charge of selecting the next block on behalf of all of us. Well, that is centralized from the get-go. Whether it's 21, or it's 50, or it's 1,000. And never mind that they may be initially honest and possibly corrupted later, the possibility is they are very vulnerable when the power is so concentrated to denial of service attack. Very cheap. So you choose a target, you have all kinds of bots and computers that send junk messages to this address, and their buffer becomes full to the hill, and these poor people cannot see anymore the transaction that they should put in the block. Really, the blockchain grinds to a halt very quickly. All right, forget delegated, how about the bonded proof of stake? Another easy idea is to say, in a bonded proof of stake, everybody is put in the middle of the table some money where you cannot touch it anymore. And anybody's welcome to push money in the middle of the table. 20 people, 200 people, 2,000 people, as many of them are willing people. And those who are willingly put their money in the middle of the table, they are the ones who select the block on behalf of all of us. And their influence in block selection is proportional to the amount of money they put in the middle of the table. And if they misbehave, we confiscate their money. Wow, this should certainly work. Does it? Let me ask a simpler question. How much of your disposable income you can put in the middle of a table where you cannot touch it anymore, is not invested in stock, is not invested in bonds, is hostage? And the answer is very little. So in a system engineered like this, The danger is that not only you make it legal, but you make it easy for big thieves with deep pockets to put a disproportionate amount of money in the middle of a table for the pure purpose of dominating and controlling our blockchain. And the notion that you can confiscate their money and that keeps them honest, forget it. We always think about that we can deter thieves by cutting hands, never works. Because in a truly decentralized blockchain, should be able to secure trillions of dollars in assets. And if I misbehave, I can benefit myself clearly, very easily, of $1 billion or two. So, if I, by misbehaving, can gain $1 billion, do you think if I care that somebody confiscates $10 or $100 million I put in the middle of the table? No. To a thief, that is just the cost of doing business. So, all these approaches have a very strange logic. They say the whole economy is secure if and only if the majority of the members of this small piece of the economy are honest. And you can immediately see that is a very fallacious logic. So what do we need is something different. What do we need is a way to orchestrate a blockchain so that the whole economy is secure if the majority of the members in this economy are honest. And that's a different business. So when I learned about this, I decided, you know, to try my hand. And the only way I know how, I lock myself for a few months and become quite distant from anything else and try to figure out what the system works. And so at the end, I end up with the same design, which is totally different from traditional ones. And because sometimes it's better to start from scratch than to patch something to work. All right, let me share with you a little bit how this works. First of all, we are not delegated proof of stake. We are not bonded proof of stakes. So what we are is a new concept, is pure proof of stake. Let me tell you what this means, that no punishments are needed. Why? Because it's much better to orchestrate the system so as to make cheating impossible. It is a fantasy that we can expose to pursue the cheaters and fine them or doing something. And so where is your money? In the middle of the table where you cannot touch it anymore? No, it's where it should be. It's in your pockets, at your fingertips, in the financial instruments made available by the blockchain. And if you look at all this money, wherever it may be in the blockchain, if the majority of the money is in honest hands, the system works, period. That's what we want. Technically speaking, what do we want is we want to endow any token in the system to have the same decision power. 10 billion tokens, each one of them has the same power. And that is the ultimate distribution that you can imagine. No? So every token is can act as an independent actor. And of course, you need technology to make this 10 billion tokens speak without getting, you know, in a very fast and secure way. Let me show how the Algorand blockchain works. What did I tell you? And what you knew, if you, and you need me to tell you, that the game is about choosing the next block. But there is one block that comes for free, the Genesis block, block number one. Why? Because that is part of the description of the system. So here is block number one. On the right of block number one, we have a tether, a universal symbol of lightness and effortlessness. And as this tether effortlessly falls to the ground, the chain unfolds. You go, wow, aren't you simplifying things too much? So where are forks, soft forks? Where is proof of work? Guess what? In Algorand, there are no forks. There are no proofs of work. What you have is a chain, one block after the other. And once you see a block, you know that this block is going to stay because there are no forks and nobody dies out. All right, so let me tell you a little bit how we want to have one block at a time in a linear fashion. And so the main assumption is that the majority of the money is in honest hands. And what are the main technological advantages of this system? First of all, the computation is trivial. Nobody solves computationally difficult riddles. What you have to do to participate to Algorand, you have to do a few additions, maybe a few comparisons, a digital signature, nothing to write home about. When the system is truly decentralized, there are not two classes of citizens, the miners and the users, the delegates and everybody else. We are in the same soup. The only users are us, whoever have money in the system. Finality of payments is very important to an economic system. Can you imagine if a wire transfer with some probability, poof, the money vanishes? Everything will grind to a halt. And why instead in this design, payments and transactions are final? Because the block in which they appear first never goes away. Actually, because there are no forks. Actually, I like. In Algorand, there can be forks, but the probability of a fork is very small. How small? 10 to the minus 18. It's a G, that's a very strange number. Of course it's strange, because I made it up. But let me tell you why I chose this number. Because our colleagues, the physicists, tell us that the number of seconds from the Big Bang until now is 10 to the 18. Therefore, yes, there may be, you may witness a fork in Algorand, but the expected time you have to wait to see a fork is same the lifetime of the universe. And at that point, perhaps, we don't care about forks very much. Scalability, we can generate blocks as fast as they will be propagated. And by the way, that is as fast as you can in a decentralized system, because you need to know what the previous block is before choosing the next one. And then finally, we have security against a bad adversary. How bad? Very bad. So we want our system to be secure, even if an adversary can immediately corrupt any player he wants, up to, say, a third of the players on the planet, which is very hard to corrupt, and can perfectly control all the users, corrupted users, and can attack not only the protocol, that is, he not only can send messages different from the ones he's supposed to send, but can attack the very hardware communication network on which the protocol is run. And in proof of work, if you can attack the network, you can double spend your money easily. Yet, the system is secure because the adversary cannot forge your digital signature. So if you cannot forge your digital signature, the system is secure. Do we need to be so pessimistic? Yes! First of all, I'm a cryptographer, so it's my professional habit to be always pessimistic. But you know, let me tell you that actually it's pretty realistic, because if we form a borderless economy, we are going to be attacked left and right, because a borderless economy is worth trillions of dollars. And with this staggering value, bad actors are going to pop up like mushrooms after the rain. So we must be prepared. Finally, tell you, how do we select a block? Actually, via Byzantine Agreement. Byzantine Agreement is some 40 years old technology and is a communication protocol, say by the people in this room, that satisfies, we talk and talk and talk, each one of us has an initial value in our heads, and at the end of a conversation, two properties occur, agreement and consistency. Agreement means that no matter which value we may have in our hands, at the end of the discussion, all the honest ones of us output the same value. So if I'm honest and I follow the instruction of a protocol, and then I output a value V, I don't know what my honest colleagues are outputting. I have a mathematical guarantee that they output the same value that I do. And then I have a property which is consistency. What does consistent mean? Just in case that everybody started with the same value, then all honest people, not only they must agree on a common value, but they must agree on the value we started with. Okay? Both properties are crucial, because assume that I get rid of consistency. And then I have a trivial protocol for Byzantine Agreement. I just say, no matter what your value is, if you are honest, output zero. Yes, ma'am. Zero. No matter what my value is. But it's a problem, because if we start with value 27, we should add to 27. If we start with 33, we should add to 33, and so on. So let me tell you how this has to do with blocks and blockchain. What is the value that we have in our head? It is what the candidate next block is, according to me and according to each one of us. Right? That is the value on which we want to find agreement. Why don't we plug in some of the protocols of Byzantine agreement directly? Because these protocols are excruciatingly slow. The maximum number of players up to a year ago for Byzantine agreement envisaging real application was 12. And most of the time was among three players, so slow they are. And moreover, they assume that the players, in game theoretic terms, are common knowledge, they are fixed and known in advance. And of course, in a permissionless blockchain, nothing is fixed, the set of players changes and increases all the time, and certainly is not known in advance. And yet, make no mistake, we want to deliver Byzantine agreement on a planetary scale with unparalleled efficiency. All right, I'd like to share with you how the system works. Well, it works in two magic phases, where the magic is actually replaced by mathematics. But I find it easier to talk about magic than to talk about mathematics. So let me stick to the magic. Magic phase one, the proposal phase. By magic, a random user is selected among all the users with probability proportional to the amount of money he or she has in the system. In other words, what I do, I choose a random token, and the owner of the token proposes a block. End of phase one, you propagate a block in the network if you have been chosen. Phase two, the agreement phase. By magic, 1,000 people are randomly selected among all the billions of users. And what do? They reach Byzantine agreement about the block proposed by the first user. Why do I need such a second phase? Because in any society, and a blockchain is no exception, there is a percentage of bad actors, maybe 1%, maybe 2%. Maybe, if we are unfortunate enough to live in a very dangerous society, 10%, maybe 20%. But you know what? The bad actors are never going to be in a majority. Why? Because otherwise there will be no society, QED. Just imagine that we leave this lecture room, and on our way home, the police robs us. We try to address the situation to go to court, and the judge incarcerates us. I mean, the jungle is a much preferable and more orderly place to live. So let's assume that we live in a dangerous society. 10% are bad actors, and therefore 90% are honest. They follow the rules. Then, if 10% are bad actors, the user randomly selected to propose a block, 1 in 10 times is a bad actor. And what can a bad actor do? Can tell you the next block is the X, and to somebody else, the next block is Y, and to somebody else, the next block is Z. And we don't have a chain at all. We have all a big confusion. But no matter what the bad actor, the proposer is bad or honest, in the second phase, we are pretty much guaranteed to have a majority of honest players. Why? Because if 90% of the people are honest and you try to select a thousand of them at random, the probability that you have a dishonest majority is infinitesimally small. So even if we choose a bad actor, we really have an agreement of what the next block is, no matter what. So if you are a user, and this time around you have not been selected to propose a new block, okay. You have not been selected to participate in the committee to agree on the block, okay. But you see, one block that has the digital signature has been approved by, say, 700 of the 1,000 member committee, then you know that is the next block, period. Okay. Says G. Silvio, at a very high level description, I have a few questions. A few? You should have thousands of questions. But we have time to handle only three. Starting with the most popular one, which happens to be that. Who selects the committee? If I understood correctly, the power, really, the honesty of the thing, it really works because we have a thousand random selected committee, and therefore we have an honest majority in this committee. Who selects it? Let's assume for a second that I say, I do. Booze, centralized like hell, right? No good idea. Good. Let's assume for a moment we say, oh, humanity debates and then agrees on a thousand member committee, who then agrees on the block. We all die before we agree on anything. So in Algorand, we do something a little bit strange. We let the committee members select themselves. Says, what? The committee members select themselves? Preposterous. If there is a bad idea, this is one. Actually, this is the second worst idea that humanity can ever have. But not so fast. Because how do we select ourselves to membership in this committee? Each one of us, in isolation, without talking to anybody, runs an individual lottery in the privacy of your computer. And this is a cryptographically fair lottery that not even a nation state with huge computational resources can select himself more than the right probability, the prescribed probability. And two cases occurs. I run this lottery, case one, I don't win. Okay, whatever I say, nobody listens to me. But if I win, I obtain a winning ticket. In other words, a short and easy to verify mathematical proof that I won the lottery, and therefore my opinion counts in this committee. I'm a member of this committee. And I propagate my winning ticket with my opinion about the block, up or down, simultaneously. Okay. Now, let me argue that this way of proceeding is both super fast and super secure. Super fast first. How long does it take to execute the lottery? 1 microsecond. Check, it's pretty fast. Now super secure. Assume I'm the big scary guy that who can corrupt anybody he wants, right? The one that the big adversary that I showed you before. What do I want to do if I'm such a big scary guy? I want to corrupt the committee, because that's where the power is. But I have a problem. Whom should I corrupt? Should I corrupt you, or the lady on the street, or this other guy in France? I have no idea. Because the committee member, only themselves know that they've been selected, because they run an individual secret lottery in their own computers. So I don't know whom I corrupt. But wait a minute. If they win the lottery, then they propagate to the network their winning ticket and their opinion about the block. At this point, the adversary and everybody else knows who they are. So it could corrupt them right away. True, but so what? If I corrupt a committee member after he or she has propagated winning ticket and opinion about the block, their winning ticket and their opinion about the block is virally propagated across the network, and I lack the ability to put them back in the bottle, because not even a government could put back in the bottle a message virally propagated by WikiLeaks. So the system is secure at a very, very high level because ex ante, I don't know whom to corrupt, and ex post, it's too late to corrupt them. All right, now I have these 1,000 people and cannot corrupt. What should they do? They should run Byzantine agreement. Wait a minute, you said that this is very slow. Yeah, it used to be very slow. We redesigned it from scratch so that each member should send only in a handful of steps, and each step, every member of the committee should say a single short and trivially to compute messages per step. And that is very easy to do. So you have to propagate 1,000 short and easy messages. So what's the big deal? Nothing. That is really fast. Then, because we are in an academic environment, I'd like to at least tackle a little bit something more sophisticated. You say, wait a second, I get that corrupting the committee is hard because they speak once. But you also say to bite the Byzantine agreement is not once. You need to have 5 steps, 4 steps. So I get you that you don't know whom to corrupt for message one, for the first step. But if these people speak more than one time, I have enough time, if I'm very powerful, to corrupt people before they send their second message, because now I know who they are, right? And so all, and that's a lot of power. And now what do we do about this? Simple, because convening a committee is so easy, we convene a committee for each step. I'm not convinced. Why? Because I assume, what is a protocol but an intelligent discussion? And what kind of intelligent discussion we can have if a thousand of us are convened, they start the discussion, the intelligent discussion, by saying their first message, comes the adversary, kills us all, no problem. We randomly select a second thousand people to say the second message. But these second thousand people do not know what they should say or what was in the mind of the first people. They're not, right? The adversary kills them all, no problem. Right? That's a very hard. Assume a few things work, such assume the protocol is for four times, select a committee, and each one of the committee for four times should shout a random number between 1 and 100. Okay? So you say 43, 72, okay. Then the adversary kills us all, and then another thousand committee shouts a random number again. Do we care if it is the same committee who for four times in a row shouts a random number, or a separate committee who shouts a random number each single time? It's the same. We have to transform the Byzantine agreement protocol so that it works in this player-replaceable way. So here is the four steps, and there are a green committee, a red committee, a blue committee, and a black committee. So what is the relationship between these people? Well, none, because they are different people. They are randomly selected. Once in a blue moon, one red committee member equals one of the green. But you know, otherwise, they are totally different. And by the way, there are different numbers too. Because they are selected by lottery, we shoot for a 1,000 members committee, but sometimes we have 1,200 members committee, sometimes we have 900 members committee. And they have no shared variable, because these people don't know with whom we have to organize what to say beforehand. And yet, they act as if they were a single committee from the beginning to end. And this means to be truly distributed. If your system keeps a committee for a month, always the same, for a week, always the same, for a day, always the same, for an hour, always the same, for just a minute, always the same, the system is insecure. Because once the adversary knows who the thousand people are, a denial of service attack takes milliseconds to launch, and nobody can agree on anything. Okay, so let me tell you a few things that are important besides the consensus. I think that the most important property of a borderless economy, of a decentralized economy, is secure self-governance. Let me tell you what this means. We have a technology to agree on anything we want. What do we agree upon? 99.9% of the time on the new block. But the same technology, we can agree on a new version of a protocol or on a new monetary policy without forking the crypto system, cryptocurrency, without splitting the community. And I think that life is about intelligent adaptation. And we cannot know now whatever our needs are in the future. But we want now the ability to change our minds and adapt, because that's the business of life. And so right now, the typical blockchain is instead a ocean liner on autopilot. No matter how carefully we can think the route, and we launch this ocean liner, now there is no pilot, no rudder, no nothing. What if there is a typhoon in the way? Oops. What if there is an iceberg I didn't budget off? Oops. Too late, right? So we need to be able to choose later what do we want, because we really don't know now what do we want. And so this ability of adapting the protocol consensually is vital to governing. And there are a few other things that matters, but let me close instead to say, in my opinion, blockchain is a really great mathematical and system challenge, engineering challenge. And we should all be congratulated for participating to this great experiment in our organization. And I bet that, you know, a few blockchains will remain to help us along and prove themselves useful. But only true technology will realize the full potential of blockchains. And speaking of technology, so here is a piece of technology on the past. This is the Pont du Gard in southern France that has actually enabled people on different sides of the river to join forces, interact, trade, meet, and has been in continual operation for 2,000 years. And as far as I understand, until 2005, they allow cars and trucks to go across it. Then they said maybe it's enough to leave it alone for only tourist attraction, okay? So I believe that the permissionless blockchain is going to be as beautiful and as useful to cement and bridge us together as humanity as any physical infrastructure we have ever created. And if we choose it and construct it the right way, it's going to hold up our planet for many years to come. And speaking of holding up the planet, we know that is Atlas' job. You know, but a few thousand years have passed, and the guy looks a little bit tired. So let's give him a welcome, a round of applause, and say thank you very much. We'll take Atlas, we'll take him from here. Thank you.